Everybody.
Good morning.
It's good to have everybody here this morning.
It's good having you here.
We're going to look at the humanity of Jesus today in scriptures. Because he was born a baby and he was a human being. So we need to see the scriptures that tells us about his humanity. So let's pray. Father, I just thank you, Father, for each one of us here today. Father, that you would take this lesson and apply it to our hearts. We might know the humanity of Jesus, that he became as a little baby, grew up. Father, all the different things that he did. We look, Father, at several different passages of scripture, that how many people called him Lord. And so, Father, we want to call you Lord this morning too. Father, we know that if you're not Lord of all in our lives, then you're not Lord at all. So, Father, help us to just take and place you first and foremost in our lives. Guide us and direct us in this lesson today. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Read Romans 1, 16 to 32, and this is kind of going to be an opening to about Jesus and his humanity. And so let me just read verses 16 through 32. It says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes, for the Jew first and also for the Greek." So he wants us to know that Christ is for everybody. And he came to save all of us from our sin. "For in the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith." Father, we want to ask you to help us to live our lives in faith to you. "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all unrighteousness and ungodliness, the ungodliness of men who suppress the truth in unrighteousness." Father, we know that there are many that disallow you as being Lord of their life, being Lord of heaven and earth. So, Father, just help us be what you want us to be. Verse 19, "Because what may be known of God is manifest in them, for God has shown it to them." In other words, they may deny that Jesus Christ is Lord, but the witness of the scriptures and the witness of our lives says different. For since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even as his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. And those who deny Christ are without excuse, because he tells us that in creation, you look up and you see the stars, the sky at night, and the sun and the moon. It just didn't happen. And they're trying to say that it just happened, but it didn't happen. God made it. And so when we look at the deity of Jesus, he is God who made all things. Without him, nothing was made. Because although they knew God, they did not glorify him as God. They were thankful, but became futile in their thoughts, and their foolish hearts were darkened. So he's telling us that because of their foolish hearts, it's darkened. In other words, their thinking is off track, and it's darkened so that they cannot see the glorious gospel of Christ. Verse 32, professing to be wise, they became fools. And we see that so much in our society, and all people are professing to know something other than Jesus. Verse 23, and they changed the glory of the incorruptible God into the image made like corruptible man, and birds, and four-footed animals, and creeping things. So for years and years, you went back through the Old Testament, they would wander away from God, and the first thing they did was went and made some image, set it up like the golden calf, and they worshiped it. And so God says, he's the only one that is desirous of worship, and we should worship him. Therefore, God also gave them up to uncleanness in the lusts of their hearts, to dishonor their bodies among themselves. We see that as we look at these next few verses, we see this happening in our world today. It happened way back then too. Even when the different ones, they took and dishonored their bodies. Says, who exchanged the truth of God for a lie, and worshiped and served the Creator rather than the Creator, creation rather than the Creator, who is blessed forever. And so they want to try to make some kind of image that they can worship. And so we're thankful that we have God's Word to help us stay on track. Verse 26, and for this reason, God gave them over to vile passions. For even their women exchanged the natural use that is against nature. Likewise, also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lusts for one another. Men with men, committing what is shameful, and receiving in themselves the personality of their errors, which was due to them. In other words, when people turn away from God, they're going to turn to ungodly things, like just talking about that. Even if they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to be a debased mind, to those things which are not fitting. Being filled with all unrighteousness and sexual immorality, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, evil-mindedness. They are whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, violent, proud, boasters, inventors of evil, things disobedient to parents, undiscerning, untrustworthy, unloving, unforgiving, unmerciful, who knowing the righteous of God, that those who practice such things are deserving of death, and only do the same but approve of those who practice them. So it's no wonder that the people gather together and make all these things up. God's word says it. For as many as have sinned, they come short of the glory of God. So, as we look at the humanity of Jesus and what he has done, and want to look at comments on the eternity. Since we think about the humanity of Jesus, the plan of God is to show man the mind of God through Jesus Christ. So he wants us to show us the mind of God through Jesus Christ. And so God had to come in a form of a baby and take on a man's human so that he could show us. Because it says in the scriptures that God wanted to talk with men, and he loved us, and he cared for us, and he had a wonderful plan for our life. But this is because God is holy, and we're unholy. God could not speak to us openly. So what he did is he took the Holy Spirit, and he sent the Holy Spirit, the Holy Man of God. And the Holy Man of God and the Holy Spirit told these men what to write. And so therefore we have the whole Bible because the Holy Spirit told these men what to write. What did they write? They wrote what God wanted to tell us. He loved us and he cared for us. And he had a wonderful plan for our life. It's like we read there in the scriptures. Man and earth. Okay, now some of your disobedience from the Lord. It took him. Wound up. Done all kinds of ungodly things. Even to turn into sexuality. And so, as we think about that, Jesus is the very thought of God working in the flesh. So Jesus is the very thought of God, what he wanted to do. So all of those things that I was saying, that God wanted to speak to us, but because he's holy and we're unholy, he did not. So he sent the Holy Spirit to do that. And then he sent Jesus. So Jesus was the very thoughts of God, working around in the flesh, expressing his thoughts and desires. So as we read the scriptures, we see that God's thoughts and desires, a lot of them are put down through the Holy Spirit, these men, and others is put down by Jesus himself, because God wanted us to know these things. So he took on humanity, Jesus did, and took on the death for us all. And that one we worship tells us that, for as many as have sinned, they will come to death. So when we talk about death in the scriptures, it's talking about his physical body dies. But remember, God has given us a spirit and a soul. And so that spirit and soul never dies. Because God made us in his own image. God never dies, as we'll see in a couple of weeks about the resurrection of Jesus. Even though he had to die, he had to die to pay the penalty for your sins and mine. So Jesus is God in the human flesh. He couldn't talk to us, so he sent Jesus. The Bible puts a face on God. So just think about, we don't have any good pictures of what Jesus really looked like. We've got some that is speculative. This is what it looks like. This is what it looks like. But when we think about God and Jesus, we can see in our mind's eye his picture. So the Bible puts a face on God. We couldn't see God, we couldn't talk to him, but God wanted to put a face on him so we could see him. How did he do that? By the humanity of Jesus. He put him in a place where he would be born, he would be raised up, he would grow, and then he would teach the people. So God wanted us to see the face of God so that we can recognize him. For now we can see him as he really is, as we see him through the Word of God. So who Jesus is and what he does. Exemplifies to us what God wants to do to us. And I've got several verses that talks about Jesus is called God. And several different ones call him God in the scriptures. And I just want to look at some of those verses so that we'll see that Jesus really is God in the flesh. And so, the first one is John 1:3. So by John, in John's gospel, he called Jesus God. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him nothing was made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. So then the rest of that in the Gospel of John talks about John and the witness that he was for Jesus. And he says, I am not Jesus. I am not the Christ. But I've come to make a way for him so that you can see Jesus So the next one is, he was called God by Thomas. Remember, Thomas was one of the disciples. So he was, after Jesus' resurrection, he wasn't there with the other disciples when Jesus came into the room and talked to them. So Thomas didn't see him. And so he told the other disciples, he says, I won't believe unless I can touch the prints in his hand and his side. I won't believe. Just need what God said to him. The next time he came, Thomas was in a room. And so he wanted to let him know that. This is when Jesus was talking to Thomas after he was in the room that second time when Jesus came after his resurrection. He says to Thomas, reach your finger here and look at my hands. And reach your hand here and put it into my side. Do not be unbelieving, but believing. Thomas answered and said to him, my Lord and my God. So Thomas recognized him as being Lord. And Jesus said unto him, Thomas, because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe. And that's what God is saying to us. Blessed are you who believe. You haven't seen Jesus. You haven't really experienced that experience like Thomas did when Jesus says, come put your fingers in my hands where the nails were. And put your hand in my side where they pierced me. And that Thomas's remark was, my Lord and my God. But Jesus is saying, blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe. So that's why God wants to tell us this morning. Blessed are you because you believe in Jesus. So Jesus was called God by God the Father. So he's called God by Jesus, or by Thomas, and by John. And now the Hebrews 1:8 says, by God the Father. But to the Son, he says, your throne, O heaven, is forever and ever. A scepter of righteousness is the scepter of your kingdom. You have loved righteousness and hated lawlessness. Therefore, God, your God, has anointed you with the oil of gladness more than your companions. So God himself is saying that Jesus is Lord. So if God himself says that Jesus is Lord, we can call him Lord too. So he claimed to be God and that he was with the Father before creation. So here God in his humanity, even before he was born as a little baby there in Bethlehem, he was with the Father in heaven. And the scripture gives us that. So John 8:51-59. Most assuredly I say unto you, if anyone keeps my word and shall never see death, then the Jews said unto him, how we know that you have a demon, Abraham. So, well, that was the wrong 51-58. Most assuredly, I say unto you, if anyone keeps my words and shall never see death, then the Jews said unto him, now we know that you are a demon. Abraham is dead, and the prophets, and you say, if anyone keeps my word, he shall never taste death. Are you greater than our father Abraham, who is dead, and the prophets are dead? Who do you make yourself out to be? Jesus answered, if I honor myself, my honor is nothing. Father knows me, of whom you say that he is your God. Yet you have not known him, but I have known him. And if I say I do not know him, I shall be a liar like you. But I do know him and keep his word. Your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day, and he saw it and was glad. Then the Jews said unto him, you are not yet 50 years old. Have you seen Abraham? And Jesus said unto them, most assuredly I say unto you, before Abraham was, I am. And God always called himself, as he referred to himself. He says, I am that I am. And now he calls Jesus and says that I am. And so, as we look at the humanity of Jesus, John said he was called God. Thomas called him God. God the Father called him God. And he was in the beginning with God. He was the great I am. So the next one is Matthew 14:33. He received worship, and only God can receive worship. which is worship the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind. So we get the indication to honor God when we worship. But watch what it says in the scriptures about Jesus. He received worship.
Yeah, it was a routine challenge.
This is in Revelations 22:8-9. Now I, John, saw and heard these things. And when I heard and saw, I fell down to worship before the feet of the angel who showed me these things. Then he said to me, the angel did, see that you do not do that, for I am your fellow servant and of your brethren, the prophets, and of those who keep the words of this book, worship God. And he said unto me, do not seal the words of the prophecy of this book, for the time is at hand. He who is unjust, let him be unjust still. He who is filthy, let him be filthy still. Who is righteous, let him be righteous still. So God wants us to say that surely my reward is with me to give to everyone according to his works. So the works of God is to recognize that Jesus and his humanity is God in the flesh. And he wants us to call him Lord and call him God. The next verse talks about sin. And we know that he tells us if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. So who is that? We think it's only God that can forgive sin. But Jesus says, I can forgive sin. So what he says in Mark 2:5-11, when Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, son, your sins are forgiven you. And this is a story about when they were in this house and all the people came, the house was clear full, and these guys brought this paralytic guy down there because he couldn't walk. And they couldn't get in because the house was too full. So they went up on the roof and took some of the latches off of the roof, and then they led him down to Jesus. And this is where Jesus is talking about this situation. When Jesus saw their faith, that is the faith of the ones that had brought him, the paralytic man, he said, son, your sins are forgiven you. And some of the scribes were sitting there and reasoning within their hearts. Why does this man speak blasphemies like this? Who can forgive sins but God alone? But immediately when Jesus perceived in the spirit that they reasoned thus with themselves, he said to them, why do you reason about these things in your heart? Which is easier to say to the paralytic man, your sins are forgiven you, or to say, arise, take up your bed and walk? But that you may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins, he said to the paralytic, I say unto you, rise, take your bed, and go into your house. So when we talk to the Lord, we've got to recognize that we can talk to Jesus, and Jesus can forgive us of our sins. He says, if you're faithful and just, ask God to forgive you, and he will. And so, Jesus is God, and he can forgive sins. So he wants us to know what is easier to say, your sins are forgiven, or to the paralytic man, pick up your bed and walk. And we have to look at the background of the scripture. This paralytic man was, from his birth, he was a paralytic. He never could walk. And wherever he went anywhere, they had to carry him around on a mat, a bed. Jesus knew that he had always been lame. He was a paralytic. So when he says, take up your bed and walk, demonstrated to those Pharisees and publicans, Jesus has the power to forgive sin. Even didn't make the paralytic get up and walk, and he'd never walked in his whole life. And he got up, took his bed, and went to his own home. So when we think about Jesus being the creator of all things, when I look at Colossians 1:16, talking about Jesus now, for by him all things were created that are in heaven, that are on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created through him and for him, and he is before all things, and in him all things consist. And he said, the head of the body is the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that all things he may have the preeminence. So when we think about the humanity of Jesus, we look around at our world and everything that we can see. He tells us that he made everything that was made. Without him, nothing was made that was made. So when we see that and recognize that, we can truly say, Jesus is Lord. Remember I said that if he's not Lord of all, he's not Lord at all. So he wants us to recognize that truth. So then Hebrews 1:3 talks about he is the sustainer of all. He sustains our life today. He gives us the power to do things, but he is a sustainer of creation. And our sun comes up every morning, goes down there every night. God's in control of that. Jesus is in control of it. When he tells us that there's so much for us to learn and to do of believing about Jesus and what he has done. So he is the sustainer of all things. Hebrews 1:3-4 says, who being in the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged out sins, and down at the right hand of the majesty on high, having become so much better than the angels, and he has by inheritance obtained a more excellent name than they all. For to which of the angels did he ever say, you are my son, today I have begotten you? Remember when John, he started out with the book of John, when Jesus came to be baptized by John the Baptist. John the Baptist says, I should be baptized with you. And Jesus says, no, the scriptures must be fulfilled. And I want to fulfill scripture. So I need to be baptized by you. And so God says that once we have accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as our personal Savior, he says, I want you to be a witness for me. And that witness is being baptized. Baptized in the name of Jesus by the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So he wants us to follow him in baptism. So then a few other things we won't look at actually in the scriptures on, but other things that Jesus did. He walked up on the waters. In other words, when there was a sea and Jesus came walking to the disciples on the Sea of Galilee, and there was a terrible storm and it was blowing so hard and the waves were so high. He's even filling the boat with water. And when Jesus came over to them, he says, peace, be still. So God wanted us to know that Jesus could still the waters, even in that terrible storm. He could take and make that storm just stop. So he walked on the waters. He healed the sick. Remember many times that people were sick. Even the part where the one guy came to him and says, my daughter is really sick. And he says, I don't want you to come to my house because I'm a sinful man. If you'll just speak the word, she'll be well. And the scripture goes on to tell us. He believed that and he went on towards his house. And when we got close to the house, all his servants come around and out and says, your daughter is healed, the fever's left her. And the man says, what time did she get healed? And they says, what hour it was? He says, well, that's the same time that Jesus says, your daughter is healed. So God doesn't have to be right there with us. He can speak the word. That's why when the word says the word is living and powerful and sharper than the two-edged sword. It's able to cut and divide right down between the joints and the marrow, between the thoughts and the intents of the heart. He knows our thoughts even before we think them, he says in Proverbs. So if he knows what our thoughts are, we better watch what our thoughts are and be, let them be honoring to the Lord. So, as he takes that God, well, then he healed the deaf. People had never heard anything. Their ears were totally not hearing. And I got a big old patch on my ear, but I could still hear out of it. And even though they got a big bandage on it, I had some cancer on it. They took it off yesterday, and so I'm doing good. And one of the neat things about it is, we went in to the doctor to get it. Where we went in, and Don took me by the hand and prayed for me that it wouldn't hurt. And it didn't hurt at all. Not even when they put the needle in there and dumped it. There was no pain. God does answer prayer. We have a great high priest who is over everything. He made the lame to walk. He turned the water into wine. And then he fed 5,000 people with a little boy's lunch. We have to remember that that was 5,000 men. So when the children and the wives and the women was there, there was way over 5,000 with the little old two fishes and the pieces of bread. And he made that so great that when they finished eating, everybody's full. They took up the fragments. There's 12 baskets of food left. Is our God a wonderful God?
Yes, he is.
He sure is. And he takes care of us, provides for us. So just, we thank him for being able to be here today and share these verses with you. And I'm going to ask Don if he would close his prayer.
Yeah, thank you, Lord.
We thank you for this time. Oh, Jesus, just fill each heart here with your presence and with your love. Let your word fill them with hope. For Jesus, you are the hope of our lives, and just fill them with that right now in every aspect of their life. Give them hope. We thank you for this time here. We bless them and bless this place. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord.
Amen. Thank you for coming in.
Thank you for coming.
Being part of the